It's good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Amen. I'm glad to have you all here today. I heard this week there was a young minister had, actually he was an older minister. The older minister had gone away for a few days, and the assistant pastor had taken over in his absence. And of course that happened this Wednesday night. I had a migraine. But when the pastor came back to the church, he talked to one of the members in the church, and he said, "Well, how did Sunday morning services go?" And he said, "Not real good." He said, "Well, how did the assistant pastor do?" He said, "Not real good." He said, "I didn't get anything out of the message." And the pastor walked away. He said it was a shame, and he walked away, and he bumped into the assistant pastor, and he said to the assistant pastor, he said, "So how did Sunday morning go?" He said, "Well, great." He said, "I didn't have time to prepare my own message, so I took one of yours." So, oh my goodness. It's all right. I can handle it. Folks, we're looking at a church here in our study. The title of the message is "When the Flame Burns Out." I challenged you last week before we read the book of the Revelation in chapter 2. I challenged you last week and asked you this question, and we're going to study it here today more in depth. But I ask you this question. How many of you remember your first love? How many of you remember your first love? How many of you remember all those googly feelings you had when you had your first love? All the strange butterfly, all the funny feelings in the stomach, the butterflies that you had. Men, you understand, you know, that first love would make you do some pretty weird things, wouldn't it, guys? You actually put deodorant on. You'd brush your teeth and take a shower. Yeah, you'd do those kinds of things you wouldn't normally do, guys. Right. Yeah, they cause you to do a lot of things. And that first love, you know what I'm talking about. And ladies, you know too. You certainly, I'm not a lady, but I know that women have feelings and emotions just like men do. And Paul is talking to a church, not Paul, but John is writing to a church. Jesus is standing right in his presence, and he's giving him the verbiage, the words to pen to this church in Ephesus. And last week, we took a look at their reputation. And I want to ask you this question, because in every one of the letters to the seven churches, Jesus says that he that hath an ear. Who is that talking about? It's talking about us. "He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches," plural. So not only is Jesus speaking to John and John is penning Jesus' words, those words are being written to those seven literal churches in Asia Minor, and also churches all over the world today, and you and I as individuals, as we do make up the church. So there's a personal application to this letter. There's an application here to the church collectively here at Beavertown Bible Church. And then there's an application to the worldwide church and this church historically in Ephesus. So he took a look at their reputation. And if Jesus was standing here in the flesh on the platform, would he commend, and we're going to read it again this morning, would he commend this ministry for their work? Would he commend this ministry for its labor? Would he commend this ministry for its patience? Having the ability to bear up under the pressure and opposition. Would he commend this ministry? And then we'll take it a step further. Would he commend you as an individual for your work within the church? For your work or your labor within the church? And for your patience? If he was standing right here, would he commend us? Well, he commended this church. He commended their service, their works, their labor, their patience. He commended their stand against false doctrine. We talked about that last week. 35 years prior to this letter being written by the Apostle John, the Apostle Paul spoke to the leadership in this church on the beaches of Miletus, and he warned them that when he departs, and he was not going to see them again. Paul spent 3 years in Ephesus. He spent 2 years teaching in the school of Tyrannus. In fact, when he spent the 2 years in the school of Tyrannus, the Bible says that he touched all of Asia. The gospel touched all of Asia. But he warned these leaders in Ephesus. He said, when I leave, I am telling you. He says, I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God. And he said, but when I leave here, he said, there are going to be grievous wolves that come from the outside that are going to try to destroy you. He said, and not only that, there are going to be men from amongst yourself rise up, and they're going to try to destroy you. They're going to try to pull people after themselves. Maybe they have another doctrine. Maybe they have another theology. Or maybe they just like to cause division in the church. He said, I'm warning you. And he says, remember, by the space of 3 years that I cease not to warn you night and day with tears. Well, here, 35 years later, this church took a stand against the false teachers. In fact, Jesus tells them, he says, I know how you cannot bear them that are evil, those that are base. He said, I know how you've tried them. You put them under a microscope. You lined them up against the scriptures, and you found them to be false. So they took what the Apostle Paul had declared unto them. 35 years earlier, they took it to heart. He commends them for that. He also commends them for their scrutiny. Their scrutiny. He tells them, you've tried those which say they're apostles and are not, and you found them to be liars. You found them to be liars. So he commends them for their scrutiny, and he commends them for their faithfulness. Because he says to them, he says, you have borne and you have patience for my name's sake. And you've labored and you have not fainted. You've not grown weary. You've been faithful. Now I want to ask you this question. If Jesus were standing right here, right now today, would he commend the Beavertown Bible Church for the same things? Remember, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches, plural. And then how does he speak to us individually? So last week we took a look at this letter, these seven verses, the letter to the church at Ephesus, Revelation chapter 2. Verse 1 through verse 7. We're going to read those seven verses again. We looked at the first point, which Jesus looked at the reputation. He commended them for the service. He commended them for their stand against false doctrine. He commended them for their scrutiny, and he commends them for their faithfulness. Today, we're going to look at him exposing the truth. He's going to show them their condemnation, that there is something that's going wrong in this church. There's one thing that is going wrong. In some of the other churches that he wrote to, he says, I have a few things against thee. I have this against you. I have that against you. But here in Ephesus, he says, I have one thing against you. You know, and sometimes I want to say, oh, Jesus, you know, and all the good things we do, all the wonderful things, you had to pick one thing. Really? Is it that important? But I want you to know the thing that he brings up to this church, the thing that he mentions to this church, if it is gone, all other things will disappear too. This is key. And this is key to us. You know, and this could even be parallel to a husband and wife relationship. Let's look at Revelation chapter 2. And let's look at verse 1. Let's read through the first seven verses. He says, unto the angel, the pastor and leadership of the church of Ephesus, write, these things saith he, that's him, Christ, that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand. That's a position of power. The seven stars are the leaders of the churches, and he holds them in his right hand. How comforting to me to know that Christ holds me and the ministry of this church in his right hand. Who also walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks or lampstands. And that was important for this church because this church was leaving its first love. He wants them to know, to a church that is leaving its first love, I am he who walks in the midst of the church. And that's very important. Look at verse 2. I know your works. I have complete knowledge of your works. Think of all the works that go on here. And I know I have complete knowledge of your labor and have complete knowledge of your patience, hupomone, and how thou canst not bear them which are evil, which are base, and thou hast tried them. You've put them under a microscope. You're Bereans. You've lined them up with the scriptures, and which say they are apostles and are not, and you have found them to be liars. They are discerning. And you hast borne and hast patience for my name's sake. For my name's sake. And you have labored. You've labored to the point of exhaustion, and you've not fainted. You've not grown weary. And I shared with you last week, if this letter ended right here, we would say, woohoo, this is a great letter. They got a great commendation. If it ended and stopped right here, it would be wonderful, wouldn't it? But it doesn't stop there. Look at verse 4, 5, 6, and 7. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left, not lost. That's key. So if I accidentally say the word lost in here today, it's by accident. But they have not lost their love. They have left thy, what's those next two words? First love. Remember your first love? You have left thy first love. And he says, remember therefore from whence thou art fallen, and repent and do the first works, or else I will come unto thee quickly, and I will remove thy lampstand, thy candlestick, out of his place, except thou repent. But this thou hast, you have this going for you, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He that saith, or he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh, I will give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. You can see in the first three verses what we talked about. He took a look at their reputation and he commended them. Jesus commended them for their service, for their stance against false doctrine. He commended them for their scrutiny, and he commended them for their faithfulness. And now in verse 4, he's going to expose the problem. He's going to bring about a condemnation to this church. After offering the church some words of commendation, he now gives a words of complaint. He's going to tell them what's wrong. And he expresses his disappointment. This church looked good on the surface. The church at Ephesus looked really good. In fact, if you and I were to look at the church at Ephesus, we were searching for a church, and we heard about all the things that were going on in the church at Ephesus, you and I would say, man, I want to go there. I want to be a part of that ministry. They are on fire. They're awesome. They're doing great things for the Lord. But there are problems in the heart that must be dealt with in this church. And we need to look at that in terms of ourself here at Beavertown Bible Church. Jesus let them know that this is a personal matter. It seems that he is grieved by the problems that he sees in this church. And we need to understand that Jesus sees exactly what we do. He sees it. He understands our motives behind doing the things that we do. He understands those. I was telling somebody this morning, I've tried to discern motives for a number of years. How many of you tried to discern motives of people? Oh, they ought to just lump us all in a heap of pile out in the field somewhere, because doesn't that make you miserable? It makes me miserable. I can't discern motives. We're not the discerner of motives. God is. We need to understand that Christ sees what we do, but he also sees what we are. He's able to look beneath the surface of our life, and he's able to see the condition of our hearts. God knows our hearts. Jeremiah 17, 5 says, the heart is deceitful and desperately wicked above all. Who can know it? Well, God can. He's the only one. When he finds error, and he finds sin in our hearts, folks, I believe it grieves him. And it hinders what it does when there's sin in our life and there's error in our ways, it hinders our ability to become in fellowship with Him and enjoy His blessings. When we allow the wrong kinds of things to linger in our hearts, it causes distress. In fact, Paul tells us that. Keep your finger there in Revelation. I want you to look at that in Ephesians chapter 4. This is a familiar passage of Scripture. Look what it says in verse 30. Now, Paul's writing to Christians. He's writing to the Ephesian church, the church at Ephesus, the church we're studying about right now, that we're reading about in Revelation. He's writing to a group of Christians, and look what he says, "And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you are sealed unto the day of redemption." When we allow wrong things in our lives and linger in our hearts, it grieves Him. That word grief means to bring distress to. Do you think the things that you do and say and think bring distress to God? The Bible says that grieve not the Holy Spirit of God. Distress not the Holy Spirit of God. Well, he examines his disappointment to them here in verse 4. "Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love." You have left it. You have left it. Now, that's why I ask you, do you remember your first love? Do you remember what that was like? Do you remember all the silly things you did, all the crazy things you did? I shouldn't say they're silly. They were very meaningful to you. They were very meaningful to me when I did them. When we think back now, they may be silly, but they really weren't silly. You know, my first love, there was only two people in life, and that was just me and her. And Jesus tells this church, you've left that first love. You know, what about you and me? What about you and I? What about you and I? You and I get so caught up in the horizontal, we lose track of the vertical. The Bible tells us to set our affections where? On things above, not on things of the earth. On things above. The only thing that I can really think of above is Jesus Christ and His glory and heaven. We get so lost in the horizontal. Well, he gives them a diagnosis. He tells them, you've left your first love. And he gives them a diagnosis here. Jesus looks at the people for whom he loves, he died for. And he tells them that they simply do not love him the way that they used to. He tells them that they have left their first love. They still love him. They still love him. But the deep, fervent, burning love that filled them with a passion to serve him has left their hearts. They love their church family. They love the church at Ephesus. But they don't love him. They don't love him like they used to. They love their doctrine. That's evident. They lined them up against scriptures, those who were false. They love their doctrine. But they've lost their passion for Christ. They love their work. He commends them for that. But they're not motivated in that work by a passionate love for Christ. They're busy. He commends them for that. But their hearts no longer burn for Him. And that flame, the flame that burned out, that burned so hotly and brightly when it was first ignited, has now gone out in their life. They've left their passion for the Son of God. They've left their first love. And you see, the Christian life that God has called us to is a lifelong growing relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. It's a lifelong growing process. Getting saved, how many of you remember when you first got saved? How many of you can remember that day? When you got saved, getting saved is growing in love with Christ. And growing in our salvation, working out our salvation, as Paul says in Philippians, comes because of what Christ is doing in us. But growing in our salvation is growing deeper in love with Him, and the love is this love is the motive for all that we do in His name. In 1 John chapter 4, verse 19, the Bible says that We love Him. Why? Yes, because He first loved us. We love Him because He first loved us. Whether we sing, whether we teach, whether we preach, whether we witness, whether we give, it must all flow out of an ever-deepening love for the Lord Jesus Christ. And if we leave our love for Him, then you know what? Our service becomes meaningless. It does. I want to show you something. Look what Paul wrote again. Look, keep your finger there and look at 1 Corinthians and look at chapter 13. And I know that the word sounds harsh, meaningless, you know, meaningless. But look, let's look at 1 Corinthians 13. Look at just the first three verses. Paul says, though I speak with the tongues of men and of an angel and have not charity, love, he says, I'm become a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. He says, and though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains and have not love, he says, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, which is a great thing, and though I give my body to be burned, to be martyred, and have not love, it profits me nothing. Our love must flow. Everything that we do, singing, teaching, preaching, witnessing, giving, must flow out of a love, an ever-deepening love for the Lord Jesus Christ. Love is supposed to grow. It's supposed to grow. I mean, I love my wife, Stacy, more today than I did when we got married. I said this before a number of times behind the pulpit. I don't know that I was in love with her when we first got married. I'm not sure, because what I feel today for her is much different than what it was then. How many of you can relate to that? That's the way it should be. That's the way it should be. I love my children more today than when I did when I first saw them. It's not that I didn't love them when I first saw them, but I love them more today. My grandson's, by the way, he had his nine-week checkup. He's not 9 months yet. He was just born in August. But he had his nine-week checkup last Thursday, Friday. And that little chunker is 14 pounds. He's 14 pounds. But I love him more today than I did when he was born. It's incredible. And I don't know how that's possible, because I loved him a bunch when he was first born. I love you folks in this church more as each day passes. Now, for some of you, the days pass faster than others. But I'm just kidding. But no, I love you. I love you guys. Jeez. Just kidding. Come on. Just want to make sure you're awake. But I love you folks more as each day passes. Love should grow. But I wonder if Jesus would have to say to some of us, you don't love me like you used to. You don't love me like you used to. It would break our hearts if our spouses said that to us, wouldn't it? Would it faze us if we knew that the Lord Jesus Christ felt that way? I talked about this last week and a little bit here just this morning, but what is the first love? What makes it so special? What makes it so special? The first love is fervent love. It's fervent. It's emotional. It moves the heart. It causes the soul to thrill. I mean, it's extravagant. It's not cold. It's not dead. It's not dusty. It's alive and it's vibrant. Remember, when you first fell in love with your mate, your love was fervent. It was emotional. I told you last week it made you write mushy letters to your wife and say things that you would have never said if love hadn't short-circuited your brain. Now, can you remember, I ask you this, can you remember when you were first saved? Some of you raised your hand. Can you remember how in love you were with Jesus when you were first saved? Can you remember that? Can you remember how it was when you were first in love with Him, His house, His people, His word? Can you remember that day? I can. Can you remember how you prayed? Can you remember how you worshiped? Can you remember how you witnessed? I remember when I got saved, even though it took time in my life for God to bring about a change. I remember when I got saved. Listen, and I had trouble. My mind was blown when I got saved because I couldn't believe that He loved me. I couldn't understand how God loved me. My mind was blown. I told Tim this morning that everybody else around me's mind was blown too. Whether they wanted to be like that or not, I didn't care because I was on fire. Did I pray like I should have? Probably not. Did I read the Bible like I should have when I first got saved? Probably not. I didn't even know what the word theology meant when I got saved, and I didn't care. I didn't know what the word sanctification, is sanctification really a word? What's the Holy Spirit? Is that some man in a ghost outfit that floats around the auditorium? Ooh. I didn't know, but I didn't care. Think how simple that is, simple-minded that is. What happens as we grow, we become so rooted and deep and steeped in our theology that we lose our first love. We know so much. We know so much about You, God. You know, a church can become so right that it's dead right. There was a man, I don't remember, it was George Wilbur, maybe Wilbur, I don't remember his name. Billy Graham said that he just left me. Billy Graham said he was one of the greatest theologians that had ever lived, that he had ever seen in his lifetime and talked to. And he asked, Billy Graham asked him, he said, what is the biggest problem, what is the most detrimental thing to the church today? He asked this guy, I think it was George Wilbur. He says, dead orthodoxy. A church being so right that it's dead right. A church being so systematic. A church having all their columns and all everything in the right columns. A so systematic church. They have everything so right that we're dead right. We focus more on our theology than we do our relationship with Christ. Jesus says to this church, you don't love me the way you used to. Remember how you prayed and how you worshiped and how you witnessed. Remember that. Remember the emotion when you thought of what He had done for you on the cross. That's fervent love, folks, and it's extravagant. You know, love will make you spend money for things you can't afford. How many have done that? Love will make you, so will stress. But love will make you spend money for things you can't afford. You buy that special person something you couldn't afford, but you knew they would like it anyways. You know what? Real love doesn't draw lines. Real love will give anything at any time for the object of that love. Can you remember when Jesus had absolute control of your heart and you would not dare to tell Him no? Do you remember that? That's fervent love. I want to ask you this. Does this describe your love for Christ? Does this describe your love as individuals for the Lord Jesus Christ? Do you serve Him because you love Him, or do you do it for a sense of duty? It's possible to labor without love, but it's impossible to love without labor. And what I mean by that is you can work and not be in love with the Lord. You know, the Bible gives us an illustration of that with the elder brother and the prodigal son. It gives a great illustration. Look at it. Look in Luke chapter 15. Keep your finger there and turn back to Luke. We won't be in Luke very long. In Luke chapter 15. You can work and not be in love with the Lord. Luke 15 and verse 25 to 32. Verse 25 to 32 reads pretty quick. It says, "Now the elder son was in the field. He was working. And as he came and drew nigh to the house and heard the music and dancing, and he called one of his servants and asked what these things meant. And he said unto him, Your brother is come, and your father has killed the fatted calf, because he hath received him safe and sound. And he was angry, and he would not go in. Therefore came his father out and entreated him. And he answering said unto his father, Lo, these many years do I serve you, I work for you, neither I transgressed I at any time thy commandment. And yet thou never gavest me a kid, a goat, that I might make merry with my friends, that I might party with my friends. But as soon as this thy son was come, which has devoured thy living with harlots," meaning you've gave him his inheritance, he went out and he blew it, he spoiled it, living with prostitutes, harlots. He says, "Thou hast killed him, the fatted calf." He took all the inheritance, he went out and he blew it, and he comes back home and you celebrate. "And he said unto him, Son, thou art ever with me, and all that I have is yours. It was meet that we should make merry and be glad, for this thy brother was dead and is alive again, and was lost and is found." You can work and not be in love with the Lord Jesus Christ. The elder brother was bitter. He was out of fellowship with the Lord. But you cannot be in love in a growing, loving relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ and be inactive. You can't do that. You can't do that. The church at Ephesus was active in the Lord's work, but they were serving out of a sense of duty and not out of a fervent love for Him. You know, they had become more like Martha in Luke chapter 10 than they did Mary, because Martha labored. She labored and labored and labored, but she labored not out of love for the Lord Jesus Christ. What about us here at Beavertown Bible Church? Are there some of us that are serving because it's what people expect from them and not because they love the Lord Jesus Christ? Love for Jesus should be at the bottom of all we do. You know what that means? It should be the foundation of all that we do. We love Christ. He's our foundation. We love Him. And so we do this because we love Him. We're this way because we love Him. He is at the bottom of everything that we do, everything that we say, whether we teach, whether we preach, whether we sing, whether we're in the choir, whether we clean the church, whether we serve as deacons, as elders, as deaconesses. We should do it all out of love for the Lord Jesus Christ. All of it. We can't always say that we love sinners like we should. I'm guilty of that. Because some are very unlovable. Just like I was. But if we love Him, Jesus Christ, like we should, we'll be able to witness to them anyways. Why? Because we love Him. Why? Because He loves them. Why? Because His will is that none perish and all come to repentance. Why? For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him shall not perish but have everlasting life. We may not always love one what we are asked to do for Him, but if we love Him, we'll gladly accept the call for His glory. Can you honestly say that your heart is still filled with that first fervent, emotional, extravagant love for the Lord Jesus? Or have you left your first love? Don't look at the person next to you or think about the person next to you. We need to read our own mail, folks. We need to read it today and let the Lord speak to your heart. Now what He does here, got just a few minutes here I want to share with you. What He does here is He tells them what the problem is. He gives them their condemnation. You have left your first love. Verse 4, because thou, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. And now he gives them the cure. We're not going to get through the entire cure, but we're going to get through part of it. The entire cure. He gives them the cure. Jesus has not come to hurt them. He's come to help them. And so he offers them words of commendation. He gives them words of commendation. He explains the cure to them. He tells them how they can fix that which is wrong in their church. Look at verse 5. He says, "Remember, therefore, from whence thou art fallen, and repent, and do the first works, or else." That's pretty scary. Let's read that again. "Remember, therefore, from where thou art fallen, and repent, and do the first works, or else." The first thing is Jesus gives them the cure to the situation, the problem that was in the church. The first part of the cure to them was for them to do what? They needed to remember. He says, "Remember, therefore, from where thou art fallen." Jesus tells these people, he tells this church, and he tells the Beavertown Bible Church collectively, he tells us as individuals that we need to look back. He wants them to remember that moment when they came to know him. He wants them to reflect on what he did in their lives. He wants them to recall the excitement and the emotion of those early days when they received Jesus as their Savior. You remember those days. I remember those days. He wants them to reflect on that. Remember those days. Remember from where you have fallen. Remember from where you were. You left your first love. Remember from where you've fallen. He wants them to recall the emotion of those days with him. He wants them to look back to a time when their love for him motivated everything that they did. Jesus, do I watch the 700 Club or do I read a chapter out of James? Lord, do I eat a tuna fish sandwich or do I eat a roast beef sandwich? I mean, everything was filtered through him. What do I do, Lord? Some of us need to remember. We've been saved for so long that we've lost the purpose of those early days. Paul tells the Philippians in Philippians chapter 4, verses 8. I want you to look at this here a minute, and I want to ask you a question when we read it. But look at Philippians chapter 4, and verse 8. Look what Paul tells this church to do. After he gets done telling them about being anxious and worrying about everything, not to do that, but by prayer and supplication, to let your request be known to God with thanksgiving, the peace of God will the peace of God that passes all understanding will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. He tells them in verse 8 to do this. "Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true." What is there about Jesus Christ that's not true? Yep, nothing. "Whatsoever things are honest." What is there about your relationship and the Lord Jesus Christ that's not honest? "Whatsoever things are just." What is there about our relationship with Jesus Christ and him and Jesus in person that is not just? He's a just God. "Whatsoever things are pure." What is there about the Lord Jesus Christ and our relationship with him that's not pure? "And whatsoever things are lovely." What is there about the Lord Jesus Christ that's not lovely? "Whatsoever things are of good report." Things that are beneficial, that are good to share. What is there about the Lord Jesus Christ and our relationship with him that is not of good report? He says, "And if there be any virtue," honor. What is there about the Lord Jesus Christ that there can't be any honor? "And if there be any praise," we certainly know there's praise. He says, "Think on these things." Remember these things. John writes to this church, you need, and Jesus says, you need to remember from where you are fallen. Some of us need to remember. We've been saved for so long that we've lost that. We've lost it. Can you remember when you first came to Jesus Christ and the weight of your sins and your burdens were lifted? How many of you remember that? How many of you remember the weight and the burdens of your sin lifted? Knowing that the blood of Christ that was poured out on the cross was done for you. And no, it didn't cover the sins. It took them away. As far as the east is from the west. Can you remember when just the mention of his name and what he did for you brought a tear to your eye? Do you remember that? Can you remember when your heart was tender and you felt at home at the altar talking to the Lord Jesus Christ? Do you remember that? Take a moment to reflect on how it used to be. And now look at how it is. Is there a difference? Can you honestly say that you're still head over heels in love with Jesus today? When a Christian grows cold with Jesus, they're in a backslidden place. They're in a backslidden condition. They need a revival. The first step to revival is remembering. Do you remember why David had all the confidence in the world when he went up against Goliath? Do you remember when David, this little ruddy, red-headed, freckled-faced boy, went out on the battlefield with some stones and a slingshot against this behemoth giant? Do you remember all the confidence that welled up in this boy when he told King Saul, "No, I don't want your armor." Because when he put his armor on him, he couldn't move. It was too big for him. And he went out on the battlefield against Goliath. When he went out on the battlefield against Goliath, how could, with nothing but a slingshot and some stones, how could he go out on the battlefield with such confidence? Because he did what? He remembered what God had done for him in the past. What had God done for him in the past? He delivered him from the mouth of a lion. He delivered him from the paw of the bear. And he knew that the strength and the power that he had to stand up against Goliath wasn't in himself, but it was only found in the person of Jesus Christ. Just like David remembered where his strength and his power and all the things that God provided through him, through his son Jesus Christ, he does the same for you and I. We need to remember that. We need to remember. And then he tells them, Jim, you mentioned this, he tells them to repent. He says, you need to remember. Remember, therefore, from whence thou art fallen, and repent. You need to repent. The word repent speaks of a change of mind that leads to a change of action. Jesus is telling the people here at the church at Ephesus that they need to repent of the sin of not loving him like they should. They need to search their hearts and change their attitude toward the Lord Jesus Christ. Look at Matthew chapter 10. I want to show you. Keep your finger and look at Matthew chapter 10. Look at what he said. This is amazing. Verse 37 to 39. Jesus needs to be the love of our life. He needs to have our heart first. In Matthew chapter 10, verse 37 to 39, Jesus says, "He that loves his father or his mother more than me is not worthy of me. And he that loves his son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And he that taketh not his cross and followeth after me is not worthy of me. And he that findeth his life shall lose it. And he that loseth his life for my sake shall find it." What is Jesus saying there in regards to the family? The things that we think are the most important or the most near and dear to our hearts. He's saying this. Is he saying that we should hate our parents? No. Is he saying that we should hate our children? No. Is he saying we should hate our grandchildren? No. He's saying that he needs and deserves to be that number one spot in our lives. The same counsel needs to be heeded by the modern church today. We've allowed everything in the world to come before the Lord, and we wonder why there are problems today. We've allowed family to come before the Lord. We've allowed fun to come before the Lord. We've allowed work to come before the Lord. We've even allowed church work to come before the Lord. Now, that's not an excuse to get out of church work, but we've allowed that to come before the Lord. We need to get back to the altars of our heart and claim that extravagant first love and fall over head over heels in love with Jesus one more time. Folks, how long has it been since you've confessed a burning love for Him? How long has it been since you were open and unashamed in your expressions of love for the King, for the Master? We need to repent of our coldness, and we need to grow in love with Jesus afresh and anew. And then He tells this church, the last thing here I'm going to share with you this morning, don't close your Bibles yet, He tells them to remember from where you've fallen. Verse 5, remember therefore from whence thou art fallen, and repent, He says. Repent, and do the first works. He tells them to repeat. Do the first works. Remember, repent, and repeat. Do the first works. They're told to start doing the things that they used to do once again. And that's the key for their revival, and it's the key for us as well. We need to get back to the first works. We need to get back to reading our Bibles. We need to get back to praying. We need to get back to sharing the gospel of Christ, to witnessing with other people. We need to get back to testifying, sharing our personal testimonies. We need to get back to crying. There's nothing wrong with crying. Jesus wept. We need to get back to praising His name. We need to get back to the things that marked us when we were deeply in love with our Lord Jesus Christ. Get back to Him today and ask Him, folks, to show you the way back. He tells them to remember. He tells them to repent. And He tells them to repeat. I'm going to finish this today, as I can finish this up in a couple minutes. But He tells them the very next words, two words after, remember, repent, and repeat, He says, or else. He tells them the consequence. If they refuse to get where they need to be, Jesus tells them that He's willing to extinguish their lampstand. I am going to put it out. He says, remember, repent, and do the first works. Repeat the first works, or else I will come unto you quickly and will remove your candlestick, your lampstand, out of his place, except thou repent. Folks, that's just what He did in Ephesus. 35 years before this, they heeded the words of the Apostle Paul in discerning false teachers and false doctrine. They did not heed the words of the Apostle John and the Lord Jesus Christ. They failed to heed the message, and He took away their light. There's no Christian work in that area today. Southwest Turkey, Southeast Turkey, there's no great Christian work in there today. There's nothing there but ruins and rubble. There was a lamp in our living room that needed a new bulb. I went and bought some new bulbs for them, light bulbs. And I changed it. And I threw the old one in the trash can. Why do you think I threw the old light bulb in the trash can? It was useless. It was no good. Because uselessness breeds disaster. A light that won't shine is not worth having around, folks. Jesus tells the church at Laodicea that. He says, you say you're for me, you say you're with me, but, He says, I wish you weren't for me at all. A light that won't shine is worth not having around. And when a church stops shining in love for Christ, when they stop being a bright light for the Lord, He will take His power and His touch, and He will put it in some other place where people will honor and love Him. Folks, I don't want God to take away what we have here. I think this is a wonderful church family. I think we're busy. I think we labor. I think we work. And I think we're patient. Folks, but I don't know you individually in your hearts, and I don't want you to grow stale. I don't want the Beavertown Bible Church to become like so many other churches in our world today. But if we leave our first love and we continue in that state, the day will come when He will take what we have and He'll give it to those who will use it for His glory. It's either remember, repent, and repeat, or it's I'm going to remove. It's removal. And He also tells of the reward in verse 7. He said, "He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God." We've heard of our Lord's words of recommending their commendation, recognizing their reputation. He brought a word of complaint. He exposed the truth. He mentioned the correction. Remember, repent, and repeat. He brought the cure. And in this final verse, he closes with the words of comfort. He says there's hope. He tells them that the reward is accessible. Look what he says in verse 7. "He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches, and to him that overcometh." Jesus speaks to the overcomer. "To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God." This word means to prevail, to get the victory. Overcomer, overcometh, prevail, get the victory, to carry off the victory. And what he seems to be saying is that there will be some in the church at Ephesus who will hear the message and they're going to heed the message. These people will seek the Lord's face. They will grow in love with Him again, and they'll be restored to that place of intimacy and fellowship. And this reward is available to every one of us who will seek it. Folks, I want you and I want me, because I'm included in all this too, to be honest with yourself and with the Lord just for one moment. I want you to ask yourself, have you left your first love? Are you busy, but busy out of duty and not out of love? Can you honestly say that you're filled with fervent, emotional, extravagant love for Jesus? Or would you have to say that your heart has grown cold, stale? That your zeal is not what it used to be? That you need to remember, that you need to repent, and that you need to repeat the first works? Folks, that's where Jesus wants us. If He had touched your heart, folks, I believe you need to deal with Him. He's touched my heart this morning. He's touched my heart all week as I read this passage. He picks on me all week when I get to read these, and then we get to pick on you. But I'm included. Folks, the time is now, and the place is here, that if we've grown cold and stale in our walk with the Lord Jesus Christ, we need to remember what it was like. We need to remember our first love. We need to repent of that. And we need to repeat. We need that. We need that in our lives. And you know what? And our Lord Jesus Christ deserves that. Doesn't He? Doesn't He deserve that?